real estate in the ways that you're putting in real estate funds that are doing things that are seemingly a market match.
Or real estate yourself, mm-hmm. where you develop a niche in a neighborhood and start adding value, mm-hmm. which might be converting a small apartment project to senior housing. Mm-hmm. It might be buying yourself a house on a particular neighborhood that fits where people all go to a church nearby or a synagogue that people, you know who your customer is. Mm-hmm. The real value coming in real estate, I see, is value add investing. You buy real estate, mm-hmm. any type of real estate. Mm-hmm. You improve it for a specific purpose or type of customer, mm-hmm. and then you sell it. Versus the old days of I'm in real estate, I'll buy anything in real estate. Right. Those days are gone. You've got to know a market before you go into it and try to develop some specialty niche mm-hmm. for your customer.
So outside of real estate and franchises, any other considerations that you think are good investments for people to consider?
I would say all investments that you yourself are the person working at heart. Mm-hmm. Generally, if it's a business that uses technology, which virtually everyone does today, I like franchises because I don't think you're going to be able to invest the time and money. And I'd rather buy retail. I'd rather pay top dollar mm-hmm. for a really high quality franchise that I know is going to work if I play it out, mm-hmm. then take the risk on the new startup franchise that someone like Paul Pilzer might start, because right. they don't always work out, and that you get a higher return, but they're very risky at the very beginning stages.
So let's give this scenario. Somebody's coming up on retirement. They're not there yet, but it's coming up pretty quickly.
How old?
Let's say 50s, mid-50s. They're going to, they've got some work life left, but they also say, oh, your retirement's coming up, and I'm looking and I really don't have the resources to just say I'm going to retire. I don't want to live on Social Security. What should they be thinking about?
Well, it's a great time to be asking that question. Mm-hmm. And the reason is underlying everything we do today is the sharing economy. Mm-hmm. In the past, I would say this is a person who likes theater, likes things he wants to do and wants to have money for the enjoyable things of life. This is a person who has certain kind of housing needs but doesn't have the money to buy the housing. Everything changes in a sharing economy mode. Because all of a sudden, we can share our real estate, mm-hmm. we can share our dinners, share our areas with people of like personality, of like interest, and add huge value. You don't want money to just go to restaurants. You want to have great restaurant experiences. Right. My wife is a real foodie, but when I go to a restaurant, you know what makes the real experience? You. Yeah. It's the person I'm dining with and telling me about the wine, and we share and we figure it out. That's much more important to adding value. Right. I'm amazed when I look around a restaurant, particularly when I see someone sitting alone who might be traveling. Right. Can't we figure that out yet with a cell phone? That there's a person here who's interested in model trains, seven other boring hobbies that I think boring, he thinks are great, right. has three kids at this school, and wow, I've got so much in common that if we only could know those things about each other, we'd have fun in a restaurant. Now, the kids do this well for dating and sex, mm-hmm. but it goes beyond just dating and sex, particularly when you get older. Right. You want to have real meaningful relationships or great dinner conversations. And so the sharing economy first helps us find people mm-hmm. of like interests. Then it finds the restaurant, the place we want to go of like interest. And before it even reveals who's who, I know this person went to my college. I pressed a button to verify that, so we're both sharing the right info. And what does he want out of me? Companionship on one meal. So the sharing economy has the ability with technology mm-hmm. to deliver so much value add at much lower prices, because by definition it's sharing, to individuals. But what we see with retired people is we all have the same needs. Mm-hmm. So once we focus on it, I would tell your friend who's about to retire to start chronicling their life hour by hour. Get up in the morning and say, what did you do at 4 p.m.? What did you think of at 5 p.m.? What did you think of at 6 p.m.? What did you need on the way home from work at 7 p.m.? Mm-hmm. And then try to think, are there other similarly situated mm-hmm. individuals at my age, with my interest, in my locale, who also might want to share with me in producing these items for others or just consuming them for ourselves? Because your individual needs in the sharing economy are the needs of other similarly situated people. And as you tune into them, you should look at them as a business opportunity for a franchise you may want to buy mm-hmm. to serve people in your neighborhood, or just meeting up with people who have common interests and common goals.
So, for example, you're saying there could be more shared real estate, like saying maybe two people who are getting ready to retire, two couples getting ready to retire.
Crazy. My wife and I love Singapore. Right. And there are many things we like about it. But 30 years ago, 50 years ago, when I was just dreaming of going to work at Citibank, I knew about Singapore. Singapore is 12 hours off Eastern Standard Time Zone. Mm-hmm. So Singapore has all these buildings owned by Citibank, Deutsche Bank, that run 24 hours a day. All the buildings and retail runs 24 hours a day. The streets are so lit up at night, you leave work at midnight or 2 in the morning and you go to dinner. and you're going on a beautiful river, you don't even know it's nighttime. Right. And what's exciting about Singapore is they use the real estate 168 hours a week. Mm. We use our real estate 40 hours a week. Think about just the real estate that you use and how you could share it. You only sleep in it 60 hours a week. Right. And you've got 168 hours. We got to figure out beds and situations where somebody, like a hotel room that rents by the 12-hour cycle, mm-hmm. not a 24-hour cycle. And you start to see so many opportunities of using just the real estate we have in multiple ways. Here in Utah, we have a center for American Express. It has 10,000 desks. Mm-hmm. You've probably spoken to people there if you have an American Express card mm-hmm. and wanted help. But it doesn't have in the 10,000 desks 10,000 employees. It has 35,000 employees who come in and work 8 hours and then move off. They get off at midnight, but midnight is 8 in the morning or 8 p.m. in Madagascar where they happen to work with their customers. And what's exciting when you see this American Express Center, you see someone taking a piece of real estate that was meant to serve 10,000 desks, used very productively by 35,000 people, so that as the earth turns and someone needs help with their American Express card or a merchant needs to know why this charge didn't go through, they pick up the phone and a person right here in Utah with their local dialect, local language, answers in the guy in Madagascar or South Korea right. or Japan and helps them. And we start to see the opportunities to use what we have multiple hours, not just for ourselves, but great business opportunities to apply that to people who are similarly situated. And what we really see is we all want companionship, we want fun, we want friends, and the technology world has yet to really deliver. Each time I go to a party somewhere, and what makes a great party for me? At my age, it's when I meet someone really interesting mm-hmm. and I want to follow up. And once in a while, I'm lucky. I go to a party, we talk small talk, we talk business, and I meet one or two new people, sometimes a friend of yours, mm-hmm. and we go, wow, let's have lunch or dinner. But that only happens when you go over and introduce me to somebody new right. and give me some background on them and probably told them, there's this economist I want you to meet. You put some work into it. Right. And I look at my phone and go, somewhere in the rest of the phones in this room, there's 50 people here that I could have something in common with right. and would like to meet. And I don't want to sell them anything or buy anything from them. I just want to talk about our latest hobby or something in politics, or I love economics, talk about economics. But no one's walking around reading my mind and their mind. And that's some of the future things coming with technology that will greatly improve the quality, hour by hour, of our personal relationships.
So, Paul, as usual, extraordinarily stimulating conversation. Very much appreciate your time. Any final thoughts before we close?
You should always remember that value in life comes from serving another human being. Mm-hmm. When you can bring a smile to a child, your spouse, your friend, or yourself, you're happy. Mm-hmm. And what we want to do is bring more happiness. And business at its root is serving another human being. It's making them happy by delivering something they want for less money or time that they could do it themselves. And when you deliver it and make them happy, that's when you get your reward. Right. And that's what's so exciting to me about economics. I see this wonderful world out there of 7.5 billion people trying to find an edge to how to serve another human being better. That's what makes economics. That's what drives them to success.
That's great. And I think in the end, that's the moral virtue of capitalism, right? Is people serving other people and being rewarded for doing so.